Good evening, everyone. Welcome to our worship service here at St. Marcus. It's good to see you all again. A special welcome to any guests visiting. Glad you all can join us as well. Please make yourself at home. Exciting night planned for you this evening. We have a baptism affirmation, and we have our brother who in Christ who is studying to be a pastor sharing the message. So it should be exciting and fun, and I hope you enjoy our worship this evening. We are starting a new series, The Fullness of God in Bodily Form. In our study of Colossians, the Apostle Paul will share with us the facts we need to know about Jesus in order to do his will. The theme for this evening is the supremacy of Jesus. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together. As always, we invite the Lord to join us, and we thank him for being with us for our worship this evening. Before we get started, please take a couple of moments to introduce yourself or say hello to an old friend, to the brothers and sisters sitting around you, and then we will start our worship. Thank you all for your conversations. Please feel free to continue those after worship. But for right now, please stand for our opening song.
Praise a hallelujah in the presence of my enemy. Praise a hallelujah. Louder than the unbelief. Praise a hallelujah. My weapon is a melody. Yeah. Praise a hallelujah. Heaven comes to fight. That I am his own. that I am your friend. So now I pour out my heart to you. Here in your presence.
Chains are released, I can through Christ in me. Yet not I, but through Christ in me.
Grace and peace to you from God our Father. He has rescued us and brought us into the kingdom of the Son he loves, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. We confess our sins today, acknowledging that we have often been taken captive by this world's hollow and deceptive philosophies, human traditions, and spiritual forces. Lord Jesus, help us put to death whatever belongs to our earthly nature, sexual immorality, impurity, lust, evil desires, and greed, which is idolatry. Help us be rid of anger, rage, malice, slander, filthy language, and lies. Wash away our sin and help us put on the new self, which is being renewed in the knowledge of our Creator. When you were dead in your sins, God made you alive in Christ. He forgave us all our sins, having canceled our debt. He has taken it away, nailing it to the cross. In Christ, we are held together. Amen. You all may be seated. I invite up the baptism affirmation family. Is this Roan here? All right. Welcome. Thank you, Skylar and Lisa, for making St. Marcus a part of this. Brothers and sisters in Christ, Roan Welch has already received the sacrament of baptism in the hospital. We have come here today to be assured of that public ratification, that Roan has been baptized properly in accordance with the Word of God, and that his baptism was not only valid, but that he now enters into the life of this congregation. So I ask the witnesses, has Roan been baptized by water and the Word into the Christian faith using the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit? If so, answer, yes, he has. Very good. Through this sacred rite, you have done what is pleasing in the eyes of God. Little children need the grace of our Lord Jesus, who encouraged the world to bring their kids to him as he said, "Let the little children come to me and do not hinder them. For the kingdom of heaven belongs to such as these." Jesus took the children in his arms, placed his hands upon them, and blessed them. God now empowers parents, sponsors, godparents, and our local congregation to bring baptized children up in the training and instruction of the Lord. We shall keep Roan in our prayers, remind him of his baptism, and lend Christian counsel and resources. Parents and godparents, if you are willing to carry out this responsibility, then respond, yes, and I ask God to help me.
Yes, I ask God to help me.
Congregation, as you now receive a new young brother in Christ into our family, if you are willing to provide what you are able to bring Roan up in the training and instruction of the Lord, then respond, yes, and I ask God to help me. Receive on your head and your heart the cross to mark you as a redeemed child of God. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, your choices are sacred, and in your infinite wisdom and grace, you've chosen Roan Welch to be yours. Strengthen him all the days of his life in his relationship with you, his Lord and Savior, and with your body, the church. May he be a living witness to your goodness all the days of his life, and may it glorify your holy name. Amen. Let us congratulate Skylar, Lisa, and Ron for Ron's baptism affirmation. You all may be seated. Our first lesson for today comes from the book of Acts. Here, the Apostle Paul is explaining the different layers of Christianity and being a Christian. As Christians, we evolve. Our faith is strengthened, and it gets stronger as we pull back these layers. We have to know what Jesus has done for us and also what he has given us in order for us to best serve him. The people of Ephesus, through baptism, had in fact turned from their old way of being in the world. They did lay down their life. They understood that layer. But they had not yet been empowered to effect kingdom change for the good of the world. They still had another layer to learn. They had not yet pulled back that layer, and the Apostle Paul was explaining that to them. That next layer, to live for Christ. Acts chapter 19, verse 1 through 10, Paul in Ephesus. While Apollos was at Corinth, Paul took the road through the interior and arrived at Ephesus. There he found some disciples and asked them, "Did you receive the Holy Spirit when you believed?" Do you know the next layer? They answered, "No. We have not even heard that there is a Holy Spirit." So Paul asks, "Then what baptism did you receive?" "John's baptism," they replied. Paul said, "John's baptism was a baptism of repentance, one layer. He told the people to believe in the one coming after him, that is, in Jesus, another layer. On hearing this, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. When Paul placed his hands on them, the Holy Spirit came on them, and they spoke in tongues and prophesied. There were about 12 men in all. Paul entered the synagogue and spoke boldly there for 3 months, arguing persuasively about the kingdom of God. But some of them became obstinate. They refused to believe and publicly maligned the way. So Paul left them. He took the disciples with him and had discussions daily in the lecture hall of Tyrannus. This went on for 2 years, so that all the Jews and Greeks who lived in the province of Asia heard the word of our Lord. At this time, if anyone would like their young ones to participate in our children's church or make use of our staff nursery, may exit the sanctuary at this time. The rest of us will join in singing our song of the day.
Feel free to rise.
Splendor. majesty. Let all the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide, and trembles at his voice, trembles at his voice. How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? And oh, I see how great is our God. And age to age he stands, and time is in his hands, beginning and the end, beginning and the end.
The privilege of starting this new series that we're having at St. Marcus. We're going to walk through the book of Colossians, and today is going to be the supremacy of Jesus. But before we get into our text today, I just want to cover a few things, a few introductory background of the book of Colossians as a whole. So we have Paul, who is our author, and he's sitting down. He's in prison at this time. It's about 30 years after Christ rose from the dead. And there's two things that I want to cover with this. The first one is that unlike a lot of other books in the Bible, or unlike a lot of other books that Paul wrote, Paul doesn't actually know these people. The story kind of goes like this. So Paul was doing a three-year missionary stunt, and it was in Ephesus. And he ran into this guy named Epaphras. Epaphras in Ephesus. It makes it a little easier to remember. And as Epaphras heard the gospel from Paul, God, in his infinite wisdom and in his grace, Epaphras was converted. So then Epaphras, this guy in Ephesus, he becomes kind of like this church planner. And he goes to this little town in Colossae. And there we read that the people cling to this gospel and they grow in their love for Christ and their love for one another. But the really cool thing for you and I is that Paul didn't know these people personally. And in that fact, we pay special attention, because what Paul says in this book, he probably would be saying if he was to write something to one of us, having never met us either. So that's the first point. The second point I want to mention is the whole purpose why Paul is writing this book at all. A lot of Christian theologians have kind of discovered just by reading Colossians that there was false teachings in the church. And there's like kind of two sides to it, and we'll cover those later. But this heresy, this Colossian heresy, it greatly concerned their church founder, Epaphras. So Epaphras, he sends a report to Paul, and he says, we need some help over here. We need some guidance. And so now we have Paul sitting in prison, and he writes him this letter. And kind of the theme or strategy he uses in this letter is, I'm going to raise Christ as high as I can in order to push out these false teachings. And so now we have our section today, chapters 15 to 20. And before I read them, this is kind of becomes Paul's first time in this epistle where he is raising Christ as high as he can. We see him talk about Christ, truth after truth after truth. And I remember in class, we actually called this a Christ hymn. Just this little section of verse, we call it a Christ hymn. Because if you look at that hymnal in front of you, there's two Greek letters that are like pasted on top of each other. It's not just some fancy scribble. Those are two Greek letters, and they abbreviate to mean Christ. Because that book, that hymnal, is just truth after truth after truth about who Christ is and about what Christ did for you. And so in class, we called it a Christ hymn, because it's just truth after truth after truth about who Christ was. And so we read, the Son is in the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. For in him all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities, all things have been created through him and for him. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together. He is the head of the body, the church. He's the beginning and the firstborn from among the dead, so that in everything he might have the supremacy. For God was pleased to have all his fullness dwell in him, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether things on earth or things in heaven, by making peace through his blood shed on the cross. This is the word of the Lord. So without knowing any people in Colossae, Paul decides that they need to hear these two truths in order to defend themselves against this heresy. And so we too hear these truths, because we need to hear these things as well, and we guard our hearts and our minds with them as well. The first one is that, the first truth that he gives them is that Christ is supreme over creation. And the second one he gives them is Christ is supreme over the church. And with these two truths, we defend our own heresies that exist in our world and in our hearts, just as the Colossians did during that day. And in order to understand why does Paul give these two truths? Like, it kind of seems a little disorganized in our minds, but we have to better understand what this heresy exactly was. What were these false teachings that were going on in the church? And it kind of has two different sides to this coin. The first side attacks directly from these Greeks, that they had their Greek philosophies, and basically at the heart of their philosophy was matter, everything physical, equals evil. Okay, they were trying to answer this question, why is there evil in the world? Why do people hate each other? Why do people die? And their answer was, matter, this physical world, it has to be evil. There has to be something greater. There has to be this physical realm, and we have to get there. So when they saw this church planter, Ephesus, coming through Ephesus, or through Colossae, they clung on to that teaching, but they didn't really make it their sole teaching. It was just kind of like another piece in the puzzle, another rung on the ladder on their way to heaven. So Paul, to refute this, he gives them a truth. And before we examine that truth, if you think that something like this doesn't exist today, I actually just had an experience that was, we just came back from choir tour where we sent out 63 students who are all trained to be pastors, and we went out west, okay? And one of our free time, and during our free time, we were all in San Francisco, and a few of us waddled into this huge cathedral, like think twice as high as this place and three times as wide. It was massive, and it was cool. They had the cross up front, they had the baptismal font as you walked in, and they had all the stained glass telling the story of salvation. But then as we made our tour around, we noticed that there's this little side room, and on the top of it, it said, "Chapel for all religions." And then around the doors, it had like all the symbols for all the different philosophies and religions that are being preached in the world today. And so at some point, like, I had to guess that that was an add-on. It was clearly looked like it was like a modern font, and it looked like it was an add-on to the chapel. And I have to assume that at some point they preached Christ crucified, but eventually either the leaders of their church or the members in their congregation, their hearts and their minds were not guarded with this truth that Paul hands over. So knowing that these false teachings are true for us today, Paul hands us the first truth. Christ is supreme over creation. And we see it in verses 15 and 17. The Son is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. For in him all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities, all things have been created through him and for him. He's before all things, and in him all things hold together. So when Paul is saying, all things are created through him, all things are created for him, all things are held together by him, Paul is saying, you live in a Christ-created, Christ-centered, and Christ-controlled universe. There's no political leader that can trump Christ. There's no, what would you say? There's no scientific theory that can explain Christ out of our world. No, Christ is supreme over creation. I actually had a friend in college who, he was with us for the first year, but then he decided that it just wasn't for him. He didn't want to become a pastor, and that's great. And he was so smart that he could probably do whatever he wanted to. So he decided to go to medical school, and he went to a secular university. And after about a year, I finally met up again with him and asked him, how are things going? And he said, Micah, I got to be kind of honest with you. When I sit in those classes, those world religion classes, and I sit in my science courses, they present some pretty convincing evidence that counters what the Bible teaches. And it's hard. He admitted it was hard on his faith. And who can blame him? When your mentors, who are supposed to be your teachers, and your peers, who are supposed to be your community, and they all just say that everything you believe is wrong, how can you not see the battle in your faith? But then he continued to tell me that, yeah, they present me with good evidence, but I have to conclude that either that evidence is incorrect or it's incomplete. Because if it doesn't end in Christ, if it doesn't center in Christ, it can't be true. God gave me this truth. We live in a Christ-centered, Christ-created, and Christ-controlled universe. And Christ is supreme over it all. So we receive this first truth from Paul. But then he gives us another truth. And this truth combats the side of the other side of this false teaching that we have. And this side comes from the Jews that were found in Colossae. So when they were first preached Christianity in Colossae, there was a lot of just confusion, like, who is this guy risen from the dead? And the Jews who were actually waiting for him, despite the fact that they were waiting for him, they didn't want to let go of a lot of traditions that they had already been doing their entire life. And so they would say, yes, your salvation is free, but also you have to adhere to our dietary laws. You still have to circumcise your children. You still have to observe our holy days. You have to do all these things still. And what they were fighting in their minds, it was more something that was inside of them. They were fighting in their minds that I have to do something to have God in my life. And this is something that exists in all of us still today, too. Maybe it comes from a little bit of pride, but it's this urge in all of us that we feel like we have to do something for our salvation. And a lot of churches will like feed into this too. Like a lot of churches will say, yes, your salvation is free, but you have to accept Jesus into your life for it to mean something to you. Or yes, your salvation is free, but you really have to make sure you feel the Spirit before it means something to you. Or yeah, your salvation is free, but be sure you come back every week for confession to make sure it means something to you. They talk to these urges, and we know that it's coming from the world back in Colossae. It's coming today, and so Paul hands us another truth. The second truth, that Christ is supreme over the church. In verse 18, he tells us this, and he is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning and the firstborn among the dead, so that in everything he might have the supremacy. So did you catch the picture? He doesn't picture us holding hands with Jesus and we're like working together for our salvation. He doesn't picture us in a pit where God is up there calling down to us, just call for help and I'll come down there and help you. No, it describes this body relationship, this head and body relationship where we are already in Christ. What this means is that his resurrection is already our resurrection. His life is our life. But what this also means is that if we think we can gain life without him, if we sever the head, the body's dead. We are dead in our sins. When we hold on to this second truth, we hang on to a lot of peace. I think a lot of Christians especially, will like put a lot of pressure on themselves. They'll say things like, can I really call myself a Christian if I don't pray enough? Or can I really call myself a Christian if I'm not being a perfect parent or a perfect son or a perfect daughter? Can I really call myself a Christian? The list goes on and on. And the answer is yes, you can. Because when it comes to whether you're a Christian or not, it's not in your hands. It's in God's. And Christ is supreme over the church. He's already connected you in that relationship. You're his. And something that always kind of like replays in my head over and over is in the hymn Christ Alone. When in the third verse it says, no guilt in life, no fear in death. This is the power of Christ in me. Yeah, we can guard our hearts and our minds in this truth that Christ is supreme over creation. I mean, over church. So we have these two truths, and sometimes it doesn't make a lot of sense to us. When I was, during last week on Good Friday, I was sitting in the back of a chapel on tour, and the eighth graders just started pouring in. And they were coming in for a chapel, and the pastor stood up front, and he gave them a little devotion. And then he said, all right, each of you are going to take a nail, and then you're going to walk up to the cross, and you're going to put it in the cross. So then each little eighth grader, they kind of picked up a nail. They kind of looked at it. Some even, like, shed some tears a little bit. And then they put it in the cross. And I was just sitting in the back, and the only thing I could think of was, I gave him the nails, and he gave me the cross. I gave him the nails, and he gave me an empty grave. It's hard for us to wrap our heads around this a little bit because it doesn't fit into the psychology of this world. And the only way that this is even possible, it's called the Great Exchange, even though, like, the only way this is possible is because of verse 20. For God was pleased to have his fullness dwell in him, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, or the things on earth or things in heaven, by making peace through his blood shed on the cross. Jesus only made this exchange. You give him the nails, he gives you the cross. That exchange is only possible because Christ is more than mere man. Christ was the God-man. He was God who came in the flesh, the almighty, all-powerful God. And so now these two truths, they're not just some like philosophy that we can hold on to, that we have guard our hearts and our minds. There's so much more than that. They're absolute truth. Because the God who created the universe, who is the center of the universe, and who holds all things together in his hand, he claims you as his own. So in this peace, may this peace, which surpasses all of our understanding, may it guard your hearts and your minds through faith in Christ Jesus. Amen.
In our prayers for the church this evening, we're going to pray for our member Carlos Whiting and his family. Carlos is in the hospital right now, battling stage 4 cancer. And we're going to say prayers for Micah Rickey, our 7th and 8th grade Word of God teacher, who returned his call and will remain at St. Marcus to teach. For a second, I thought those applauses were for me. Then I realized I didn't do anything to... Also, prayers for thanks for Roan, Skyler, and Lisa for Roan's affirmation of baptism. And then we're going to ask the Lord to be with us as we prepare our hearts and minds for the Lord's Supper. Let us pray. Dear Lord, today we praise you for being supreme, for creating us, ruling over us, and loving us. Please forgive us when we worry and think things are out of control. Through your mercy and grace, remind us who is always in control. Lord, we pray for the health of Carlos. Please be with the doctors and the nurses as they care for him. We also ask that you give Carlos strength. Please relieve any pain or discomfort in your time, Lord. And continue to comfort all of us who love and care for Carlos. We thank you, Lord, for guiding Micah's decision to stay here and serve at St. Marcus. We have been blessed here at St. Marcus in the many ways that Micah shares your gospel truths. Continue to bless and support him and his family as they serve you, Lord, and your people. Father God, we give you thanks for holy baptism, for your forgiveness and making us part of your family. Through the affirmation of baptism, pour out your blessings on Rome that he may remain in the grace of his baptism all his days. And Lord, we thank you for your true body and your true blood. Continue to guide us by your promises and your truths. We ask all these things in the name of Jesus, our risen Lord and Savior, who taught us to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, power, glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. At this time, I would like to invite our communion helpers to come up. Please give your attention to the screens as I explain our continuous flow. We're going to form two lines in front right here. You're going to come up on the inside of the hand railings. You're going to come up to the communion rail where there'll be bread and wine on both sides. And then we're going to exit on the outside of the hand railings to the north of the sanctuary. And it's over there you can dispose of any cups that you have. Please, let me remind you, our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given it, he gave thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take and eat. This is the bread which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Then our Lord took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to him, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always. Everything has been prepared. We will start from the front of the sanctuary and make our way to the back.
Hallelujah, hallelujah.
come on, my soul. Oh, don't you get shy on me. Lift up your song, 'cause you got a lion inside of those lungs. Get up and praise the Lord. Come on, my soul. Oh, don't you get shy on me. Lift up your song, 'cause you got
before the news.
overwhelmed. Alone you pray. You met us in our suffering and bore our shame. Abide with me. Abide with me. Don't let me fall. Don't let go. Walk with me. Never leave. Ever close. God, abide with me. Love that will not ever let me go. Love that will not ever let me go. You never let me go. Your love will never let me go. Abide with me. Abide with me. Don't let me fall. Don't let go. Walk with me. Never leave. Ever close. God, abide with me. And up ahead, eternity. Weep no more, but sing for joy. Abide with me.
May his true body and his true blood strengthen and preserve your faith to life everlasting. Go in peace, knowing your sins are forgiven. Amen. Please stand for our closing song.
Generations falling down in worship to sing the song of ages to the Lamb, and all who've gone before us and all who will believe will sing the song of ages to the Lamb. Your name is the highest, your name is the greatest, your name stands above them all. All thrones and dominions, all powers and positions, your name stands above them all. And the angels cry, oh, all creation cries, oh, holy, you were lifted high, holy, holy forever.
Oh, if you've been forgiven, song forever and amen. Creation cries, holy,
Please be seated. I'd like to thank you all again for joining us for worship this evening. It's been a privilege and a pleasure to serve you all. I'd like to give a special thanks to all of our service helpers this evening, from our talented musicians, our ushers, our greeters, our communion help, our excellent production team, and a special thanks to Micah Otto for sharing the word with us this evening. Can you please give them a hand for their time? Here at St. Marcus, we give our thank offering for what the Lord has done, and we know he will continue to do. We have baskets in the back, and we have a few digital platforms as well. Our St. Marcus website and our app are ways to send in prayer requests. So if you have those, please send those in, because we would love to pray for you. I have just a few announcements. The next growth group session starts the week of April 14th. You can join our growth group through our Church Center app. If you're not sure which group you should join, ask Pastor Hine or Kate Krieger for recommendations. And Kate is right over there. Also, please consider ways to support our Embrace Grace Moms ministry. There are a few ways that you can support them, so if you have the time, please consider those. And lastly, there's a women's Bible study on Esther. The women's Bible study on Esther is Saturday, April 13th, in person, and on Tuesday, April 16th, virtual. And just as a reminder, always, you can always check our website or check our screens to stay in the know or to find ways that you can support our ministry. Thank you all again for joining us for worship. Peace and love to you all, and God's blessing. Have a good night.
Sing a little louder. In the middle.